from her home in San Diego 7 years ago. Well, today a grand jury is trying to sort out exactly what happens. We'll have the news right after Rosie.
Hi, I'm Maureen O'Donnell, and this is my sister's show. Today is the day she's waited 35 years for. Her guest, Barbra Streisand. Hit it, John!
Again?
Maureen.
Maureen, you look so familiar. So, you were in that bedroom with me, weren't you?
That's right.
Maure, can you believe this?
No, I can't believe it.
Do you think I'm going to get through?
Yes, you'll get through.
Tell the people truly why you're here.
To keep you calm. And in case she faints, it's my show.
No chance of that. Sit down and shut up. Please say hello to John McD and the McD LT.
Oh, yeah.
Hello, John.
Well, hi.
How are you?
Good.
Are you okay?
I'm so excited for you.
Oh, my God.
Believe it.
I can't even.
I know.
I brought some of my stuff.
Let's see.
I don't even, you know, what? And I got a couple flowers. I hear she enjoys roses. I hope.
Good.
I didn't even watch the, I just was like in my room listening to Higher Ground, her new CD, which I adore. I know all the cuts and all the lyrics. Don't start me, please. I have my Barbra mugs. I'll give her the big B.
All right, big.
I'll take Back to Broadway. This is, I was not actually in Las Vegas. 1994, I did see her. Every appearance here in New York.
Right.
This is the MGM Grand from the first concert, Champagne.
Wow.
I had a friend of mine get it for me and send it. It's been on my shelf.
Oh.
The thought that I'm going to be able to have sip my Barbra Champagne with Barbra herself.
Barbra.
I'm putting it in ice. I don't even know what to say. I have all my buttons. I have everything. People said to me, just be yourself, you know. I've tried to be her for 35 years. How can I just be myself? My own 45 secondhand rose. Stony end. These are actually my mom's, you know.
Yeah.
My mom loved Barbra Streisand so much, and I used to take all the 45s and play them on the clothes and play record player.
Right.
My mother would get so mad because they get scratched because the clothes and play was a kid record player.
Yeah.
My mom would be like making ragu. You know, she was not a great cook. She's Irish, you
right.
know. She'd be making us ragu in the pot, and I'd come in, like, you know, the house, like second grade, come in, and I'd do my Barbra Streisand impressions for my mother to make her laugh.
Right.
And she loved when I used to do secondhand rows.
Oh.
And I used to do, even Jake the plumber, he's the man I adore. Had the knife to tell me he'd been married before. That would crack her up. I'm not telling you. And that's all I, okay, oh. What else did I bring from my refrigerator? Magnets I have. This is actually off my refrigerator. Oh my, Barbra, it's okay. My hands were shaking. Did you notice? I'm fine.
Yes, you
I
are.
I am fine.
That's right.
Look, you know, my son, it was so funny, my son, I've been teaching him, I say, who's on mommy's show? He says, Barbra Streisand.
Oh.
I says, what does he sing? He says, people.
Oh.
What about that? It's 2.5. And I have such service that my daughter who is only 2 months old. I don't want to bring her out yet. I didn't bring her today, knowing that 20 years from now she's going to be in therapy going, you know, my mother brought my brother to the Barbra Streisand show and left me at home with a sitter. You know that's going to be scarring her for life. But what could I do? The chances of all my 8-tracks, look at Songbird, sings from the heart, each word can tear you apart. Greatest hits, you know, love theme, evergreens on there. But, oh, God, how about this? The way we were, it's on there. Okay, it's all right. I'm all right, everything's good. Now, the thing is, normally in this part of the show, I talk about my day, my night, how I've been. I've been having diarrhea. A bit. I'm better now. I have a Ricola in my mouth to retain moisture. I will not be wasting any more time.
Good, all right.
I asked them to put together a little thing in my favorite moments. They will. We'll go to break. We'll come back. And, you know, we'll be here. Miss Barbra Streisand. Take a look at this. Out there, dreams do come true. Please welcome, I knew I would do this, Barbra Streisand. Self-indulgently, that in many ways to me it feels like my mom walking through the curtain, because I have to say that you were a constant.
You're going
to
make me cry.
I'm sorry. You know, I don't want to do anything that would upset you in any way, but you were a constant.
constant source of light in an often dark childhood, and you inspired me and gave me the courage to dream of a life better than the one I knew. And I am profoundly grateful to you in so many ways.
Is appropriate for this moment.
This is it for me.
Yeah?
Really? It is.
From there. Yeah.
My entire life. I have to say, I don't remember my life without you in it.
Oh my God.
It's the truth.
Well, I thought, when did you find out about me? I mean, when you were how old?
Well, the truth is that you opened it. I could get it for you wholesale the day after I was born.
No.
Honest to God. And my mother...
I'm that old?
No. You were so young on Broadway.
Right,
you were
yeah.
so young. And my mother adored you. And wow. I don't ever remember your music not being on in our house.
Really?
Every year we decorated our tree to the Christmas album.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. It's a... And you're gorgeous. Look at you.
I'm gorgeous.
You're gorgeous! I thought it might be difficult.
You probably know more about me than I do about me.
I do.
I forgot.
I probably remember things you don't remember. Like, remember when you won the Oscar and you walked up and you tripped a little bit on the way up with the
You would remember this.
I remember that. But you were so good. And you were talking about how in the theater you'd have to do so many performances.
That's right. And I could be in my bathtub and have millions of people watching me while I was taking a bath, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Is there anyone when you were a kid that you felt this way about?
I don't think so.
No. No. Because I've read Judy Garland had a profound effect on you, but...
No, what I told Celine, what I told her was that it reminded me of when I was with Judy Garland. But Judy, what I remember about Judy, and I admired her tremendously, she was brilliant and kind and, you know, she was grabbing onto my hand with cold, cold hands because... She was frightened, and
really?
I wasn't frightened when I was 21. No. I'm more frightened now.
Really?
The truth. Yeah, there's more to live up to, you know. How do I fulfill your fantasy of me?
Can I just say this? My fantasy of you is always rooted in truth. You, with your the statements that you make, the mm-hmm. speech that you made at Harvard, and,
you.
You know, it's not just a kid's impression. As mm-hmm. I grew into be an adult woman mm-hmm. and you're directing and all mm-hmm. of those things, it's reality-based. There's no illusion. It's you,
that's good.
You know, as a mom and as everything.
Oh, that's good.
But I
that's
bet
good.
That must be hard for you because people do hold you, start to cry and sob when you sing.
Well,
that would be me. Sorry.
Because, I don't want to disappoint people.
No, and do you worry that you do? Because...
Sometimes. I used to more, you know, before I did concerts.
Right.
And I thought, well, they hear me on record where you can perfect everything. When you go out and sing live, you sing live and you could have flaws, imperfections, and,
right.
and that came with time when I said, you know what, I love the flaw. I love the imperfections. I mean, there is no such thing as perfection.
That's true, but
it's
might I say that
imperfect.
You come very close, because I saw the New York concerts, and that was very hard for you. Did your stage fright initially develop from this feeling that everybody was very, you know, treating you as like this goddess legend? Because
My stage fright. You know, I always had stage... Well, no, I didn't have stage fright at the beginning when I was 18 and 19 and 20 and wanting to prove to the world that I was somebody, you know?
Right.
But when I did open up on Broadway in Funny Girl...
At the Winter Garden Theater?
Yes.
All right, go ahead, just say.
And I was on the cover of Time, and at that time Life magazine, and people were saying I was terrific or great or whatever. I said, what's great? What could be so great? You know, so I became very nervous walking out on stage, like, how do I live up to this, what's written about me? Do you know what I mean?
Right.
And so then I got stage fright.
Is it true that you never missed a performance on Broadway?
I did miss one.
You did?
And well, I had wisdom teeth taken out, three of them. Didn't miss that one.
Really?
Woke up with a scratched cornea, but my stepfather, who had never seen me perform, came to that performance, didn't miss that one.
Right.
But I think I must have had like 104 fever, total laryngitis, and missed that one.
And did Lainey Kazan go on for you?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, because she sat here and told me she never got to go on.
Oh, no, she went on.
She went on
the press.
She did? Of course, that's Lainey, isn't it? She had everyone
that's
she
okay.
ever met in the audience. Yeah.
It was okay. I hated missing that performance, but I had to.
Yeah. And then you went over and did Funny Girl in London.
Yeah.
Did you miss any there?
No. How about this one? I found out I was pregnant opening night. Wow. Can you imagine? No one wanted to tell me. I'd taken a rabbit test a few days before, but no one told me the results, and I was busy rehearsing.
And you let somebody else read the results?
Well, after the show, my friend Sis, who's still here with me, my best friend since I was 16, after the show, they didn't know what effect it would have on me to know I was pregnant before the show. I might have said, forget the show. I'm going, you know, just want to dwell in this
motherhood,
you know. So after the show, she came in and said that she's going to be a grandmother. And I said, she had an older son. I said, you mean he knocked the girl up? And she said, no, you're pregnant. So afterwards, after the show, when everybody's congratulating me for Funny Girl,
right,
I was saying, thank you, that I was pregnant.
Right, you know? Right. And did you tell people right away?
No, I couldn't. We just opened up. I was saying, I'm pregnant. I have to leave the show tomorrow, you know?
Right. And so
I did stay the first 3 months, which is your hardest time. You can lose the baby.
Right.
Even her daughter fell off a London bus, and she didn't fall off, I fell off the bus. I saw we left the daughter, she didn't get on the bus, so I jumped off the bus, rolled a few times. But if a baby is meant to be there and meant to come into the world, you know,
she will come. Yeah, I have a new one.
I congratulations.
Thank you very much. She's so very cute. Little eyes like you.
Really?
Yes. Yeah. We have to do a commercial. I was hoping we could do the whole hour with no commercials, but they told me I can't do it.
They need the money.
You know
okay.
how it is.
Okay.
All right.
I'll share it with
back
you.
Back with Barbra Streisand, believe it or not, after this break.
She's a young Columbia recording star, a very great talent. Here's Barbra Streisand, so let's have a nice welcome for her.
The sky is blue, the night is calm, ho, the moon is new, but love. And while I'm standing here, this heart of mine is singing, lover, 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 get yourself here to me. Now,
get back.
I'm fine, I'm fine, I grow now, I'm fine. My mother doesn't spank me just for going without a hat. She knows darn well I'd run away, cause I'm too old for that. What does she think, I'm three? What does she think I'm for? I'm more than four. I'm even more than four and a half. I'm five. On August 29th.
Barbra Streisand. With my stickler for details, I know that your birthday is April 24th. On the record, you say that. See, and on there you said August 29th.
Well, I was married to Elliot Gould at the time. I was being generous to him and loving, so I said his birthday.
It was his birthday. That's sweet. If you ever do that song again, on March 21st.
Yeah, March 21st.
That's me, March 21st.
Yeah. I ever sing it again.
All right.
March 21st.
Now, you went to the theater frequently as a child, yes?
Well, my first show was when I was 14 and I saw Diary of Anne Frank. Sat in the top balcony for $1.89, I remember.
Wow.
Couldn't believe it because I thought, why aren't I up there playing this part, you know? She was a 14-year-old girl.
Right.
But it was spectacular. I used to come from Brooklyn and go to the theater.
This would be the playbill?
Oh, come on.
I heard the story,
wow.
And I got to
really?
The original playbill.
Oh, my God!
Oh! So good. I thought, do you collect stuff like that? I have every playbill I've ever seen a show from. I kept it.
Really?
Yeah.
I have kept a lot of them.
Yeah.
But I do have a stack in my New York apartment.
That's yours to keep.
You're kidding.
No,
thank
please,
you so
take
much.
It. Look what else I have. This is your
great.
First. I can get it for you wholesale.
Oh, that's right.
And this is when you were lying in your bio about where you were from.
Yeah. Well, lie? Yeah, right.
It says...
Yeah.
Well, it's funny. It says,
well,
Barbra
yeah.
Streisand is 19, was born in Madagascar,
right.
And reared in Rangoon.
Rangoon.
Oh, yeah. Rangoon. Sorry, I've never heard of it. Where is Rangoon?
Somewhere near Africa, I think.
It is.
But, you see, the point was, in those days, everybody said they were a member of the Actors Studio.
Right.
And everything was so sort of pompous and serious. And I was playing a Jewish secretary. So to say in my bio that I was, you know, from Brooklyn, I grew up in Flatbush, meant nothing. I thought if they thought that I came from Madagascar,
right.
Reared in Rangoon, I changed it. The next playbill said I was born in Aruba and went to the Yeshiva of Brooklyn. And my last line was, I am not a member of the Actors Studio. Now what happened was the playbill people came to us and said, you can't do that. I was trying to be funny.
Right.
And they said, you can't do it. It has to be serious. I said, ah, two, you know.
Because you did get it. Because you know what? When I did Grease on Broadway, mm-hmm. I wanted to write, Rosie O'Donnell originated the role of Effie in Dreamgirls. That was the Jennifer Holliday role. Right, you don't know where you could have played that. But they wouldn't let me. They're like a stickler. I think you're the one who made the rule.
Can you believe it?
I can believe it.
I made the unrule.
That's right. And yeah. I got it right there. You can't have this one. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Did you want it?
No.
All right. That one's for me.
I can get
good. Now, can I just ask you, do you like snacking? Because, first of all, you're so gorgeously fit.
I like eating, but I dieted for you.
You did?
Do you know what that's like to diet? Because I love food. I love, love, love to eat.
How long did you diet for me?
I would say 5 days.
Oh, my Lord. You know what I did for 5 days?
No.
Had diarrhea. I did. I was so nervous. I did. I had the little, yeah.
That's a great way to diet.
It is, actually. Yeah, well, normally a snack, what do you like? A chip?
Snack.
A Kit Kat, a Hershey bar. What's your favorite snack? Are you like a chocolate?
No. Haagen-Dazs ice cream cones.
Oh.
In-N-Out burgers.
In-N-Out, they're pretty good in L.A.
You know, I do health food sort of during the week. Eat a lot of tofu, but then I get this urge, you know, for those coffee ice cream cones and
yeah,
chocolate cake.
Chocolate cake. Do you make it yourself?
No, but my housekeeper does.
She makes
a chocolate applesauce cake, the recipe of which I got from the New York Times. Fantastic.
Really
if
good.
If you'd like it, I'll get you the recipe.
Would you send it over? I'd appreciate that. I'll put it in my pile of stuff, the Barbra Streisand housekeeper chocolate cake.
Yeah, right.
Now, are you a good, I know that you love to have Chinese food. Is this true? You used to work
in
a Chinese...
Yeah, I took Chinese cooking classes. I took... I know how to make a great chocolate souffle.
Really?
Yeah. I don't know how to make coffee.
No.
But I can make chocolate souffle.
Do you know what's funny? Before my mom died, she taught each child how to make one meal.
You can.
Isn't that sort of profound in a way?
Yeah, what was your meal?
My meal was London broil. And
I remember London broil.
London broil.
We used to always have London broil in Brooklyn. We had London broil.
We had it on Long Island, too. Thin slice. And we took the Seven Seas Viva Italian. That was the marinade.
Really?
Yeah, we poured that on the top, and you had to take a fork and stick it in, flip it over.
They have a pounder for this meat, you know?
Not on Long Island.
No, not on Long Island.
No, they don't. We had that's what we did. But really? I'm not really a good cook. I love the Chinese food like you, though.
Yeah, I love to figure. I read a cookbook once on a plane for 7 hours,
yeah,
cover to cover, because I love understanding the chemistry of recipes. But to actually stand there and do it, by the end of you should see what I look like in the kitchen. It's just really bad.
Do you bake like cookies and stuff around the holidays? Do you do any of
that? I could lie and tell you I do, but no, I don't.
No, I don't either. But I'm just curious to see what you do.
No,
I don't do that either.
I would like to do it, though.
We got a lot of stuff.
But I'll tell you what.
What?
You know, with your two children, that is a fun thing to do. I love to decorate cookies.
Oh, yeah, that's good. You know what they do now, too? They have the Christmas cookies on the sugar cookie, the Pillsbury, and they have, like, a design of a tree in it in green.
Right. Well, red, that used to be in Brooklyn, red and green sugar on the top. Ebbinger's Bakery, anybody remember?
Ebbinger's Bakery. No, never been there.
No?
Good stuff. And how about when you're in your concert, you talked about the Mallow Bar?
The Mellorow.
Yeah, I don't know those.
You're kidding. Because you moved out of Brooklyn.
Yeah, we moved to the
unfortunately,
island.
Unfortunately.
That's right.
As you talked about in so movingly on your show about breast cancer.
That's true. It was startling statistics, Long Island, I have to say.
Yeah, and I remember envying the girlfriends who could afford to move out of Brooklyn to Long Island.
Mm-hmm.
And when I watched you on that show, I thought, how do you like, you know, God works in mysterious ways.
Yeah. And in fact, I want to talk to you more about that after the break, about... President Clinton's mom, who you dedicated this record to and inspired this record, and about the Breast Cancer Foundation in her name. So we'll be back to talk about that and more with Barbra Streisand right here.
You guessed?
Yes!
Who's the best yet? If you ain't, I'll tell you one more time. You bet your last dime.
Just a piece of sky.
when people do tell me stories, I often wonder if they're true or not.
So most of the time they're not.
Well, I think this one might be. I'm not sure.
If it's a friend of yours, maybe it's true.
That when you were deciding whether or not to do Yentl, that you went to visit your father's grave, and on the gravestone next, it was the name Anshul.
That's right.
That's true.
And I mean, that was the sign, yeah. They left that out of the article on me recently. But that is true, yeah. It was the first picture I ever had with my father. I never had one with him when he was alive.
You were just a baby, 15 months old.
15 months old, yeah. So I asked my brother to take me to see his tombstone, and so I have a picture with me with my arm around the tombstone. And
was that the first time that you had been there?
Yeah. I was, I guess I was upset that he left me.
Yeah. I was 20 before I went. It's a hard thing to do.
Yeah, isn't it?
Yeah.
But the interesting thing, I mean, a week later when my brother sent me the picture is when I saw the name of the tombstone next to my father's was Anshul. No, it wasn't Irving or Sam.
Right.
Anshul is a very unusual name, which is the boy I played in Yentl.
Right.
Isn't that amazing?
That is sort of astounding.
I mean,
yeah.
It makes you really know there's something out there that's
something happening
more powerful than us.
The movie was so moving and such an amazing accomplishment for a first-time director. It's just astounding, and you were the first woman ever to win a Golden Globe for directing.
Thank you.
Yes, you were, ever.
You were.
Ask me if you want to know anything about you.
Right.
I'll tell you all your credits and your accomplishments. That's one of them.
Wow, I didn't even realize that.
Yeah, and how did you feel that day when you were there? I watched a fan sent in a little tape he made called The Envelope Please of every single award you ever won, every acceptance speech. And
with the trip on the Academy Awards?
Yeah, the little trip
I saw.
And you singing with Neil Diamond and with Barry, everything you've ever done on an award show.
Really?
Yeah, and the Golden Globe speech, you seemed very moved with that.
I was, because I didn't expect it at all. I mean, after all, I wasn't nominated for an Academy Award. So to get that award for Best Directing was really something special, not only for me, just for women in general.
I agree. And it had to be hurtful, the Academy Award, to not be nominated on a lot of levels. That I'm sure it was painful.
It didn't feel good.
No, of course.
I would have preferred to be nominated. But, you know, I always think it's people who don't like my work. And then I have to realize, oh, you mean there is a sexist attitude and all that stuff.
But when you're so immensely gifted in so many areas, I think it's so hard for people to continue to lift someone up who is already so much above them.
I hold the press responsible for this. I mean, more than the general public. You
right.
know? Joseph Pulitzer had a great quote. He said that a cynical mercenary press will in time produce a people as base as itself. In other words, the self-projection of the writer onto us, you know, people like us,
right.
you know, that we did this, and they make up these stories that are not true. It's like as if in order to stand tall, you have to stand on top of someone else.
Right.
And that's not true, is it?
I agree. It's not true at all. And I know in Superman you talked about that. Don't believe what you read.
Yeah.
Remember that?
Right.
Just
I read something recently, too, that Mother Teresa said that she doesn't read the news because she wants to know the truth.
Hmm. Interesting.
But that was quite profound.
And I know that you said on the Barbara Walters interview that the New York Times did three wonderful articles where you and the reporter got along really well and they killed them.
They never saw the light of day, yeah.
You see?
Yeah.
Well, you know, it's astounding in a way, isn't it?
The people have to fight back. The people have to fight back. We all do, because we're so powerful. I mean, each and every individual, you know, get people elected, change laws because of Princess Diana's death, let's say. Something may happen now in terms of privacy laws. Ultimately,
I think goodness does win. Because even like with this show, they said it wouldn't stay on the air because people don't like
And
kindness.
I wrote you a note about that, didn't I?
It's framed in my living
You're
room.
You're kidding.
Oh, no, it is. Yeah. What do
I
you think?
Because... No. I was so happy to see you succeed on this kind of level by being kind, by being a good person and not having to denigrate other people, make fun of people, by loving people.
Well, I do love you very much. I think you're so amazing. I do. Do we have to go to commercial again? I hate commercials. Okay, Higher Ground is the CD that I swear to you we'll talk about after this. It's just this, it's Barbra Streisand, there's a lot to talk about. All right, so we'll be back with the CD. Don't go away, okay?
Can you hear me? Papa, can you see me? Papa, can you find me in the night? Papa, are you near me? Papa, can you hear me? Papa, can you help me not be frightened?
coming up today at 4.
Higher Ground is the brand new CD that debuts at number one, ladies and gentlemen.
Right?
Number one, as you should always be. And here is Virginia Clinton Kelly, your good friend who inspired inspired the CD. Tell everybody how you came about doing this.
Yeah, well, unfortunately, it was at Virginia's funeral. And I was sitting in the audience, you know, amongst hundreds of people. And this girl started to sing this spiritual song called On Holy Ground. And the music just united everybody in their love for this wonderful woman, you know? And I just was so overpowered by it, the power of the music, that I said, I must sing this song. I must make an album in Virginia's memory and sing songs that inspire me.
And it's very inspirational. It's very moving. It really is. And I love the title track, Higher Ground.
Isn't that good?
Yeah, it talks about, you know,
too, what we all aim to be, to walk on higher ground.
Right.
Take the higher road.
Yeah. Yeah. Do people ever sing your songs right to your face?
Not like you.
You know, because it would be rude, right? To Barbra Streisand to just...
Nothing you do is rude.
Nothing?
No.
All right, in that case. No, because I was thinking, what could I possibly do? You know, do you have a favorite movie of yours?
Several.
Yentl.
I like Yentl a lot. I loved Funny Girl and I liked The Way We Were. I liked People.
Were you ever watching when I used to go, Barbra, can you hear me?
Yeah, well, I used to hear about it, then somebody would send me a tape.
Right.
And then I would go, you know, she talked about you, really? What? Somebody sent me a tape, and I go, sending me messages.
Funny Girl, was that the best movie you think for, you know, just, I mean, I think that's the best movie.
I like that movie.
Your favorite song in there? Favorite song?
I guess it's People. Yes, it's People.
We have that right here.
People who need
is more?
Yeah.
All right. All right, that's a line I've never heard, trust me. I never use. It's always more is more, you know?
You know what? I knew more looks good.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Now, you know, I'm so happy that you're happy.
I know, I'm happy that I'm happy.
You seem very happy. And on your Barbra Walters interview, you seem so happy and so relaxed, and can I just say that your honey is a honey?
Isn't he?
He's a cutie patootie, isn't he?
Oh, boy, yeah.
Did you ever watch Marcus Welby?
Never saw Marcus Welby.
Never. Steve Kiley, not familiar to you.
No, I wasn't, and he never saw my things either. He never saw Funny Girl. I had a show in Funny Girl.
And you agreed to date him?
That's funny.
I will not date anyone who cannot sing me the entire first verse of Sadie, Sadie, Married Lady.
That's funny.
It's the truth. You think I'm kidding you?
Oh,
you think
she'd
come
funny.
Out and chat with us?
Now?
Two of you?
Sure.
Share a little champagne, perhaps?
Yeah.
All right.
Sure.
We got to go to commercial. I wish we didn't.
You kidding? It's over already?
No, it's not over. James Bolin's going to come out.
Oh, good.
And I'm going to sing a little.
Fast.
I'm Marty the Martian. Hit it, John. I'll just serenade you on the way out. My sister will sing along. People in the audience who know, this is for you, Barbra. Ready? I was sitting on a hill. I was looking at the sky. And that's when a strange-looking object caught my eye. I tried to run away, but I couldn't even stand. When the great big flying saucer came into land, dance break! Why, it's
funny.
I know. Well, you know, I try as best I can. Hey, James Brolin coming up next with Barbra Streisand. We'll be right back.
The friendliest bear around.
Starts Friday, December 12th at theaters everywhere. 2 weeks ago, Rosie O'Donnell lost the Mary Tyler Moore Trivia Championship.
Just a chance to get my title back is all I ever asked for.
Now Rosie wants a rematch, and Monday she's taking her case to court. The People's Court.
Excuse me, Davina, but you did not pass it.
Will Rosie get a chance to reclaim her title?
Again, Your Honor, she's answering the question wrong.
The Honorable Judge Ed Koch will decide.
The evidence will speak for itself.
Rosie takes her case to the People's Court.
You can't take the truth.
La, 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 la.
Monday.
We're gonna see what you guys are made of. You'll be given orders and there'll be no time to ask why. Just do it, and do it right. You start thinking and questioning, and that one moment of thought could cost somebody's life. Quite possibly yours, and quite possibly mine. And that would be a mistake.
Yeah.
Yeah! He's a cutie patootie. Please welcome James Brolin. It makes me all warm to see you like that, smooching on my show.
Where'd you get that record?
Oh, did you enjoy that little number?
That's
from my collection
20 years
of
ago.
James Brolin Sings. Did you know that he had a James Brolin Sings record?
Yeah, he told me, but I actually dug it up and found it and made him a tape.
This is like number one on the 98 cent rack.
Yeah, I think that's where we found it, actually. Was this a short-lived career?
1972, and I haven't done it since, so it's pretty short-lived, yeah.
Now, this is the song.
We've come a long way on this East Texas.
Now, did that debut at number one, James? I'm curious.
Did not.
It didn't. That's a surprise. It's such a surprise.
Number seven in Portland.
Yeah. Now, can I just say, you're so adorable, and you were here on the show, and you know they told me not to talk about her on the show, and so I was a little stiff with
you. That was a mistake, wasn't it?
Well, because I didn't know what to do then. I was thinking, oh, my God, those boys are in love with the lady that I love, so I want to stay. And then I caught it, so I was like, duh.
But you brought it up anyway.
I had to. It was like I couldn't hold it. I got it, Barbra. You know what it was like for me? It was like an addict. I had to have my Barbra fix.
Yeah. She wanted to do impersonations for you and everything.
I was going
to
do whole Marty the Martian for you.
You guys had me in tears back there. Your union had me. Absolutely. And the clips are beautiful. And you know, this girl, thanks for giving me my life back.
Oh, sweet. How sweet is that? You too? Now, is it true, James Brolin, that, I didn't mean to interrupt the kissing, is it true that you never saw Funny Girl?
Never saw a Funny Girl.
What, did you live under a rock?
Well, I guess so.
Where were you when the Funny...
I was busy. I don't know.
You were busy.
But I mean, our relationship was based on two people sitting down. She didn't know much about me.
That's right.
It was a blind date.
If I had been there at the restaurant, I could have filled you in on your entire career. Amityville Horror, Marcus Welby. I could have named every movie she ever did.
Oh,
but no.
God.
Now, what's the deal? You had a really weird haircut when you first met?
It was a buzz cut. It was about this long. I was like a prickly pear.
Like a bullet with stubble.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It wasn't this gorgeous.
You remember my dark hair?
No.
Well, they had just shaved it off, Marine style.
Yeah. Really?
Right.
And I had a little white that had grown out.
It was spots.
And
like
I had this date that night, which I tried to get out. I was very insecure about my hair. I was very insecure about having a date with this person and who needed it. I'd been living alone for 3 years and finally decided I liked myself.
Yeah.
And
you know what's
interesting,
by the way?
And you'll never find anybody.
What's interesting is that you can, I think you find someone, your soulmate, when you are okay with being with yourself.
Right.
Yeah. You know, when you can appreciate your own solitude and your own company.
Right.
And then you can really let someone in, you know, when you're not desperate.
And that, you see, I'm still desperate.
It's
all right.
Okay, you have your children. Right,
yeah, it's true. Yeah, I'm not good at being alone either.
No, I always have
people over. Linda Richmond lives on my couch, pretty much.
Yeah,
it's true.
Yeah.
Now, you, congratulations are in order. I hear you directed your first film.
I did.
And that it won an award at the Hollywood Film Festival?
Won Best Film.
What about that, Mr. James Brolin? That's amazing. Now, did you get any advice from Barbara?
Well, she was over there with me. She'd get up every morning and at 5 o'clock and cook me these fabulous bread. She's off-the-cuff gourmet cook, you know.
I heard a story about your directing, your first experience, that you showed Yentl to Steven Spielberg.
Later, when it was done.
Right, when
it was
done.
Finished.
And that they said Steven Spielberg gave Barbra comments about the film, comment was, don't change a frame.
That's right. Really?
Don't change a frame.
Don't change a frame.
Because it was perfect.
It's a beautiful.
Most of the marginal films are done by committee now. I believe in one point of view to make a good film.
Yeah.
And that's what she did on both her films, all three.
I love her almost as much as you do, I guess. When are you getting married? You don't have to tell me. Soon?
Of course.
Sometime soon.
All right.
I work Monday to Friday live at 10. You know, this show is off for hiatus at Christmas, and again in February, I have a week. I'm just mentioning in case scheduling was going to be a conversation tonight over Chinese. Love to have you over. Anyway, but I wish you guys all the best. In fact, we're going to go to break. We're going to come back and toast you guys after this commercial break, so stick around. Just because I found this, you know, out, and I've known it about you, that you personally have contributed over $23 million to charity in your life and career, which is an astounding number. And I just wanted to bring that up. And the Streisand Foundation, which was founded in 1986, that by you, that helps women and equality and equal
children.
Rights and children. And that's an amazing thing that you did. And I wanted to bring that up.
Thank you.
And now, I know we have a lot.
Isn't it nice, because you have a foundation too, isn't it nice to give it away in your lifetime when you can feel the reward?
It's true, when you have enough. I got enough.
I got enough too.
All right. Yeah. Listen, I know that you have a doll collection.
Yeah.
And I have a doll collection, only mine are different, but this is a very hard to find little kiddle.
Oh, is that cute?
Yeah, this is like when I was a kid, they had these dolls and I never had them. So Jackie Ellen, Bernice's daughter, she had the little kiddle. Mm. So now I know you don't collect those kind of dolls, so that one's for me, but this is for you. Look. Antique Schmagegi. Researched. Don't even ask.
An antique Schmagegi?
It's a rare.
Beautiful.
It's a Kessner antique doll. Rare mold.
German
circa 1890.
Oh,
it's got a bisque head. What does that mean?
A bisque.
Yeah, bisque head,
bisque.
Right.
Not bisque.
Bisque, right. Bisque head. Open mouth. It comes with an antique. It's made.
Beautiful.
There you go. That's for you, because, you know, I love you if I haven't mentioned it. Just want to congratulate you guys on, please don't spill. Oh. Thank you, that would have been horrible. You know, I'm a little of a perfectionist here. Okay, that you guys, I am kind of, it's hard to believe, but I am. Okay, hold it.
You have any peach juice? It's great in the champagne.
Oh, geez, had I known
I
you like peach juice. That's gonna haunt me. I'm gonna be in bed tonight going, if I only had the peach juice, it would have been
I was only kidding,
All right,
here,
give that to you, honey. And this is for you. And this is,
Thank you,
for years of happiness and for all the joy that you've brought me and everyone. I thank you for being
thank
here.
Thank you for being you and the kindness you've shown.
Thank you. Cheers to you. And to all of you, thank you so much. We will see you on Monday. Bye-bye.
Destinations in 45 countries worldwide. American Airlines, something special in the air. While in New York, guests of the Rosie O'Donnell Show always find themselves in the lap of luxury. Hotel Westbury, home of the world-famous Colo restaurant.